what it will be. This thing we do together on Sunday mornings and lots of other times, it's an ingathering of people who know who Christ is.
What my eyes will see when your face is looking at me. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel?
Thank you, David. Probably the only church in the country that got a pumpkin patch mentioned in its communion prayer. Makes sense.
I can only imagine all creation bowed down. The whole
number of us that are adults that have this faith that's sick because specifically of Central Christian Church, I think you'd be amazed.
Resurrected in the healing light, surrounded by your glory.
I would put this congregation, when it comes to children's ministries, I would put it up against any church in the country. I absolutely.
I stand in your presence. To my knees will I fall. Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine.
His power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations. Now and forever. Amen. Man, I love your church. And I know you do too. So continue to use
what will.
Little review of this series that is wrapping up today called Imagine. And I wanted to show you that video because I think it serves as a nice little reminder of how great a church this is. My goodness. You know, as I watched that and as I considered some of the images and some of the things happening, we have been for 4 weeks looking at just one very specific scripture passage that the Apostle Paul wrote. But again, as I consider some of those images and what's happening around here, I'm actually thinking about some of his other words. When he wrote in Philippians that not that I have already obtained this. I think that's a pretty key phrase, actually. Not that I have already obtained this. But I press on. You see, I think this is a congregation that is pressing on. A congregation pressing on to be a house of prayer. A congregation pressing on to share the love and the life that is found in Jesus Christ outside of these walls with our community and inside with each other. And I think this is a congregation pressing on, not that we have already obtained this. It's a journey, it's a process, we've got a long way to go. Isn't that true of all of us though, not just churches? I think this is a congregation pressing on to be a place that takes very seriously and very intentionally God's command to pass on the faith to the next generation. I do. I absolutely do. And that is essentially the message or messages of the last several weeks. But today, I'm kind of through talking about us and what's happening around here. And Instead, I want to spend just a few minutes, and really it is going to be just a few minutes, talking about God. Talking about God. You know, the scripture that Becky read to you, that was read to you to begin the series, that has been a part of our prayers during this series, that has been part of our benediction during this series. I'm thinking you've got to be Ephesians 3, 20 through 21 experts by now. I had to read it again because of two reasons. One, because as I've done on other weeks, I wanted you to notice a particular phrase. And the one for this Sunday is immeasurably more. Okay? Immeasurably more. And we're going to get to that. But actually, I want you to notice another scripture, and that's why I started at verse 14. Verse 14, which is Paul's prayer for the Ephesian church, okay? It begins with this phrase, for this reason. Okay? For this reason. So he then goes on to pray. And then after that prayer is when he offers that doxology that we have, again, lifted out loud and in other places and in other ways throughout the series quite a few times. So the question is, Paul, and this happens a lot when you read Paul. There'll be a phrase like therefore, or for this reason, like today, and you have to go back, okay? You have to know the context, and you have to know the setting. That's really true of any good study of just about anything, sacred or secular. You need to understand the big picture, what's happening. And that's so often true when you read Paul. It's a great prayer, right? For this reason, I kneel before the Father. Love that imagery. From whom his whole family in heaven and earth derives his name. I pray. That's a clue that we know it's a prayer. That out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being. Becky read it a few minutes ago. You get it. But why? Why the passion? Why so much energy? Why so much enthusiasm? Other than that's just what Paul does. Why, for instance, does he kneel? Well, it's because he's talking about the love of Christ. And he just can't help himself. If you go back to Ephesians chapter 2, and you pick it up there, well, then you start to get a sense of why this language at the end of chapter 3 is so emphatic. And so enthusiastic. And why he prays so deeply for this church. And then why immediately he gives this church some assurance that God is hearing their prayers. And God, be assured, God is answering these prayers in ways that are immeasurable, in ways you can't imagine. Because he's talking about the love of Jesus Christ. Let me read you a little bit of chapter 2. Really, really, all of Ephesians, beginning in chapter 1 up until the end of chapter 3. Really, when he says for this reason, he's referring back to everything he's written so far. But really, chapter 2, verses about 1 through 9, they really capture. It's kind of the heart of this book. But as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live. When you follow the ways of the world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming age he might show the incomparable incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I mean, there it is. That is the good news of Jesus Christ. That is the story. That is the message. That is the gospel. Okay? It is why in telling the story of what God has done through Jesus Christ yet again to another church in another place, it is why Paul then prays, please, oh please, may you grasp, may you understand, may you know how deep and how wide and how long the love of Christ is. He wanted them to know they were loved. He wanted them to know about Christ's grace. He wanted them to know they are saved. Saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And so now, church, now it is my prayer that we can tie all this together. Because you see, when we read a phrase like immeasurably more, a phrase we have been reading for 4 weeks in one way or another, we, by now, I pray, we should have a grasp of what immeasurably more is. Immeasurably more is God, who is rich in mercy, making us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is God raising us up with Christ and seating us in the heavenly realms. It is God showing the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in kindness to us through Jesus Christ. It is God saving us not by our works so that no one can boast, but through faith in Jesus Christ through grace. Is anyone in this room besides me? And that is the whole story. That is all I've got. You see, there might be a phrase before you like immeasurably more, and it might be a Sunday like Commitment Sunday. And so maybe you are imagining, thinking, dreading, I don't know, that because it's Stewardship Sunday, Commitment Sunday, and there's a phrase like immeasurably more before you that what was going to happen today was I was going to stand up here and ask you to imagine immeasurably more ministry, more mission because of more giving. I'm just now thinking about that. That would have really been a good idea. But that's not the message today, because that's not the message. It's not about us. And it's not about our faithfulness. And it's even not about our obedience, and it's not even about our giving. Those are all good and important things. But it's about God. It simply is. That's the story. That's the message. That's the gospel. And that's all I have. Because as you consider your response, as you consider your pledge, your promise, your commitment, how can we not respond, promise, and commit in any other way than is immeasurably more when we consider what God has done that is immeasurably more than that immeasurably more? You still following me? So, you know, I don't know, maybe in some way, part, mind, somewhere in between. There is someone, because they tell us pastors that if there's this size of crowd before you, there's always someone. That there's someone in this room that is hearing about these incomparable graces and this love and this salvation for the very first time. And if that is you, and if that is you, the invitation is to dive in. Is to dive in, because I'm telling you, Christ's love is deep, and it's high, and it's long, and it's wide. Or maybe you have heard this story many times. You have heard this story since you were a wee lad or less. And it's a great story, and you know it's a great story. But it's time to recommit to the story. And to remember that there's others that don't know about it. Praise God. Praise God for His immeasurably more. Praise God through our time, our talent, our treasure, our worship, our service, our obedience, our listening, our prayer, our study, and yes, through our giving. Okay, church, this is the time of commitments. This is the time of response. Knowing and having been reminded of what God has done for you through His Son, Jesus Christ, I do invite you to consider those yellow cards, and as we stand and sing, to bring those forward. And I thank you ahead of time for the commitment you make. And I thank you ahead of time for the promises you keep. Because of God's commitment and God's promise, there is abundant and eternal life to be had. Stand and sing.